stuff. What can figure it out? That's how it chooses you.
Oh, hello, Teresa.
Hi, Claire. Hi, everybody. I've given up on hearing you out of both ears. You're only in my left today.
That's all right.
That's just how that's going to go.
Given today's topic, me being only in your left ear is probably good.
Okay, good. I'm glad it works out. Hold on. Let me reach for my coffee. Oh, and then I stood up and now you're in both ears. So great.
We just fixed it. We're geniuses.
That's what we are.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, good.
Hey. Genius and idiot are very closely
related.
They're
so close. That spectrum is a circle, and genius and idiot are the start and finish, or finish and start of that circle. That's right.
Truer words were never spoken, Teresa. Just our small interactions today have been really indicative of my week.
Oh, yeah.
Which is Claire consistently attempting to deal with her own grouchiness and frustration at little tiny bullshit things that happen.
Yeah. I mean, good job. This is not indicative of my week, except that, you know, in the fact that it's a normally simple thing that is suddenly very complicated for no reason. That, like dog digestion, that has been a problem this week. This normally works, and when it doesn't, it's very terrible. Let's just put it this way. I'm really glad to see you. I'm super thrilled to be talking with you today. I feel like it's going to be a good change.
Yay.
Yeah.
So I was grumpy a good portion of this week, and it was just little things like, you know, oh, I live in this beautiful state and it's been cloudy for 3 days. We are so spoiled in Colorado with sunshine. And obviously being on solar, there's an added thing, which is we have less power.
If there's no sun, I can't use this blender. What am I going to do?
And if there's anything that riles a white person up, it's having a little bit less power.
Yeah. Not being able to have juice when you want it. Oh my God. Right. White people go crazy.
I had to develop a strategy for the week, which was to get in bed. This was in the evening. You know, I'm not insane.
I mean, you're talking to somebody who has gone to bed in the afternoon the last 3 days, so.
No, I mean, I love naps. But my strategy was to get in bed with my hot water bottle that I was gifted for my birthday, get under the comforter, and binge watch Monty Don's Gardener's World.
Oh my God.
Which is a BBC show about gardening.
Yeah.
And it's the most comforting, lovely thing to watch.
Can we talk some gossip about Monty Don right now?
Do you have Monty Don goss?
I do. I have the hot goss. No, I don't really. Except that...
You're not allowed to tell me anything that makes me like him less.
Oh.
Oh, okay. No, do it. I'm into it.
You may not like him less. I think he's learned. We hope he's learned out of... He's educated himself out of this position. He did a show, and I don't know if it got picked up, but it seems like it did because there were 6 episodes, and it was called Fork to Fork. And it's like garden fork to plate fork, right? He did it on his property, Longmeadow. He did it with his wife and children. I don't want to speak ill of his children because they're children and they all seem delightful. But the thing I like best is that I think it's his daughter who has like bright red hair. Mm. And so it's like a family and then there's a spirit child. It's pretty cool. So that was fun. But in that, one of the episodes... He is supposed to go out to the orchard of young trees and put down landscaping fabric around the base of them to stop weeds from getting nutrients that he would rather the trees get. And he goes off for like, it felt like 15 minutes, which on TV time is probably 45 seconds.
Every 45 seconds of television equals 15 minutes in the real world. This is fact.
That's the equation. So for a longer time than I expected, he went off about how the Soil Association, I think he's in Herefordshire, the Soil Association of Herefordshire says you're not allowed to use glyphosate, which is Roundup. It's like Monsanto chemical glyphosate because it gets into the water. And he goes off about how he thinks they're wrong. And about how he wants to be organic because he believes that it's the right thing to do. But he ends by saying, but there are gray areas.
Oh, Monty.
Monty Don's gray area is whether it's okay to use Roundup on an organic property. And I was like, oh, I know who this guy is now a little better. I get him a little bit. And like, okay. But it was really funny because the reasons he gave, it is more work, right? He's like, you go out, you spray it around the tree. The whole orchard takes about an hour and you only have to do it once a year. And it's amazing. And this landscaping tarp, it looks so tacky. He literally is like, it just looks horrible. It's purely about aesthetics. Like, I'll use a poisonous chemical because it looks better and it's easier for me. And the fact that they didn't edit that out sort of shows you, like, the place gardening was in at the time, where that was still, like, an attitude it was okay to have and still have a career.
Yeah.
But anyway, he makes me laugh a lot. I feel like I know him in a certain way. That show's on YouTube if you guys want to find it. It's called Fork to Fork. And you can watch, yes, you can watch all sorts of things, including Monty Don talking about how Roundup is good.
Michael Pollan has a book called Second Nature, which is about gardening, which is a lovely read. I read it several years ago. And I remember him talking about gardening as this conflict between order and chaos. And how man is attempting to bring order to this, the chaos that is Mother Nature. And you've just made me realize that in the conflict between order and chaos, Monty Don is definitely pragmatic when it comes to establishing order, right?
Yes. Everyone's a little bit fascist when the dandelions come out. Everyone's a little bit fascist.
Right.
When there are dandelions in the orchard. Also, how hilarious that they're framing it as the conflict between order and chaos when nature's not chaotic at all. It's fully ordered, and it's a series of very intricate and involved closed-loop systems that all work together. It's pretty much magic. And then there are the gardener, mostly white dudes in our culture, who are really into the idea that that's chaos, and they're the ones who are going to bring order to it, which is another really fun lens to look at those shows through, for sure.
I've been thinking a lot about that because I've been in the garden so much lately. And part of why I was grumpy is it was less this week because the weather was a little tough. And we put up a windbreak around our garden fence because the wind is a real thing that seriously harms our plants. And I thought, oh, am I fighting with Mother Nature in this act? You know, but I just don't know what else to do in this moment. So just even putting up a clear boundary where I'm like, wind may not come here. It's like, ah, the wind might find a way. I'm very aware that this could be all be folly.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting, right? To be in an area that's not necessarily the most hospitable for row crops and to be trying to grow row crops. Yeah. The wind is a real thing. You have to negotiate with it.
Yeah.
Except that it doesn't negotiate. It's like, no, I'm going to blow right here. Good luck.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny because people don't understand about the wind here.
I mean, regularly 60 to 80 miles an hour. Regularly. The wind is a car that's driving across your property at highway speed.
And never runs out of gas. Which is why we really do want to put up a windmill. Because solar is great out here, but obviously wind is another resource that we can exploit. Just kidding. Another resource we could take advantage of.
And then at least if it's windy, you're getting something out of it. That's the thing. It makes the wind have like, oh gosh, the wind's so annoying, but also I can have 4 hot baths today because we have all of this power, right?
It really would, I think, change my attitude about the wind. And I've gotten much more used to it than I was last year, but I feel like at some point I'll just start walking sideways, you know, just sort of crooked, and that'll be my norm. And everybody will be like, what's up with you?
You guys aren't constantly walking against the wind?
Vaguely bent towards the southeast, away from the prevailing winds. That's Claire.
There she is. You can tell she's always crooked that way. Crooked Claire. There she is on the horizon. That's how you'll come to my house next. You'll just like catch the wind and land in my front yard. Be amazing. Can't wait.
It's going to be great.
Not to spend a whole lot of time talking about the weather, because that's maybe not the most interesting thing, but the snow this week can go fuck itself. Period. Yeah. It's like, fuck you guys. It started snowing and I was like, there are buds on the lilacs again. We're going to miss lilacs again because of this late snow bullshit. Like, fuck off. It's April. Go away.
Oh, I know. It just threw me for a loop. I was just riled up all week, Teresa.
Stupid snow. Oh, like you.
What's the point of you now?
There is no point. I just am. Shut up. Come on, guys. Let's be cold together. No. Get out of here. You're killing the flowers.
I love it. I think you're really good at personifying.
I'm very, very good at personifying weather. That's actually my hidden skill. Now we know.
Put it on the business card. Teresa Sparks, podcaster, weather
impersonator. I'm a weather impersonator. This is high quality content. This is great. Let's talk about the weather more.
This is the podcast. It chooses you.
I am Teresa Sparks.
And I'm Claire Patton.
We talk about things we enjoy and we talk to you about them. And please like, download, subscribe. Is that the thing we're saying? Like, download, subscribe. But the download is the most important. So we should say that first.
Yeah.
Download. There you go. Thanks.
You said it like three times. They're going to get it.
They're going to get it.
It's so clear.
You can find it wherever you already found it. And then also you can find it in other places. So Apple Podcasts and Stitcher and Spotify are the main ones. Go for it.
Do it. Well, Teresa, I'm very excited because today on It Chooses You, we are talking about pranks as political activism, or as I'm calling it, pranktivism.
Pranktivism. Yay! That's so, I love it so much. Okay, let's go.
We're talking about the tricksters and mischief makers fighting for social change.
All right. As Janelle Monáe says, we'll put water in your guns. We'll do it just for fun.
Yeah. Sources, very quickly. The podcast Conan O'Brien Needs a Friend. There's an episode that features, a recent episode that features Adam McKay. Mm. And I've used that as a source. There are two documentaries that I used as sources. One is called The Yes Men, and the other one is called The Art of the Prank. The Yes Men is available on Amazon Prime. The Art of the Prank is on YouTube. I use the website history.com and Wikipedia, of course. And actually, there were a couple of very, very good articles in Teen Vogue.
Teen Vogue is actually killing it the last 6 or 7 years.
I had no idea. The articles that I referenced specifically are from Kaylin Ralph, and there's another one from Eve Upton Clark.
Cool.
Fantastic. Check out Teen Vogue. Check out these writers. I feel so hip.
Teen Vogue.
I just wanted to make a note here at the top that with this particular topic, sometimes it's difficult to suss out who's involved in which group and who's involved in which prank. Mm. Part of this particular work is to put a focus on the message itself. I'm going to be highlighting the acts themselves, but also the actors behind them, because I think they deserve some applause from us. But also, they often want to hide their identities because on occasion, what they're doing is illegal, you know.
But the fun kind of illegal.
I apologize if I've inadvertently received wrong information about people's names or things, because I think that there are some pseudonyms on occasion.
I got really excited because I have been, after our Nick Miller conversation of a few weeks ago, I have been watching New Girl. And as we know, pranks or poor quality pranks or pranks that don't quite make it as pranks are a big part of that show. Thanks, Winston. So I'm very excited.
I've learned a lot this week in investigating this. And what I've discovered is that if I were a part of a prank group or an activist group, this would be it.
Yeah, you found it.
I found my activist language. Mm. And I love it because to me, joy and humor is the only answer for the darkness. It's the only antidote possible. Mm-hmm. And obviously these pranksters are using laughter as a tool for social change. I'm really moved by that. I feel very emotional about this one.
That's great.
I'm very inspired.
Yeah, I love that you have pranks are your activist language. That's a really great mm-hmm. way of saying it. Mine, unfortunately, is like righteous arrogance, which as we know, changes no minds or hearts ever in the world. All I do is make enemies. So I'm really glad, of course, you have a more reasonable one that actually brings people together. Of course you do, because that's who you are.
So I'm just basically going to tell you about a bunch of really cool people doing crazy stuff. So I'd like to start by talking about the Yippies. If anyone doesn't know, this is the Youth International Party, or Yippies, that were established in the 1960s. They were led by, in addition to other people, Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, and Paul Krassner. They were a group of activists in the 60s who responded to absurdism in society and politics with their own absurd activist theater and pranks. There's something really cool about these groups in the way that they hold up a mirror to society, and they one-up society or politicians or corporations in their absurdity. In 1967, during a peace protest in D.C., Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, and Allen Ginsberg staged an exorcism of the Pentagon. It was a big group of people, and they were dressed in wild costumes and aided by healers who tried to exorcise the demons of war out of the Pentagon and levitate the building itself. Classic theater, right?
Yeah.
That same year, Hoffman and some of his associates snuck into the New York Stock Exchange and dropped hundreds of dollar bills onto the trading floor. And this caused a feeding frenzy where all the traders stopped what they were doing and scrambled for this cash on the floor. That was the visual on the news.
Mm-hmm.
We call that bad optics.
Yeah, now there's a name for that.
And obviously it highlighted the greed.
Well, sure, but we call it bad optics because it's revealing what's actually fucking going on, which is this just like greed that is so powerful that you will punch your colleagues in the face to get some money from the floor.
One of the principles of these groups, I learned, is making the invisible visible.
Yeah, there we go.
And I love that. And this is a classic example of that. That greed is there, whether we talk about it or look at it or see evidence of it in the moment. So it's creating these opportunities for the invisible to be made visible. And this is classic. It's so perfect. I'm not going to get too deep into this because this really would deserve its own episode, but we're going to briefly talk about the trial of the Chicago 7.
Okay.
At one point, the Chicago 8. In 1968, during the Democratic National Convention in Chicago, a major protest was planned of young people, activists. But leading into that convention itself, Mayor Richard Daley cracked down, saying that he was going to ramp up police presence. He fortified the convention center where the DNC was taking place with barbed wire. And he just generally made it clear that he wasn't going to tolerate protests, and he certainly wasn't going to take any guff.
This is not what we do anymore. I think de-escalation is a major goal, at least, or stated goal of many police departments in many situations. Not 1968, buddy. Not 1968. Barbed wire, more cops, arrest hippies, arrest anyone protesting, go. Yeah.
So lefty activists, including the Yippies, staged a festival of life instead of a protest. So they billed it as, this isn't a protest. This is just another event that's happening simultaneously. They had music, there was dancing. I'm sure there was quite a bit of drug use. They nominated a pig named Pigasus for president at this event. Their goal at the time was partially to take media coverage away from the DNC, but also they wanted to create a spectacle of joy. So on August 28th, there was a police riot in Grant Park when a young man lowered an American flag and police and National Guard attacked protesters, including the Yippies, among many other groups. At Grant Park that day, protesters were beaten and tear gassed indiscriminately. This was, of course, all caught on camera, and the American public could clearly see the violence on their TV sets. That Chicago, as biographer Jonah Raskin said, is a police state.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, 6 months later, famously, SDS leaders Rennie Davis and Tom Hayden, graduate students Lee Wiener and John Franes, Christian socialist David Dellinger, Yippies Reuben and Hoffman, and briefly Black Panther Bobby Seale were all brought to trial for conspiracy to incite a riot and interfering in police operations. At one point, Hoffman quipped, "Conspire? Hell, we couldn't agree on lunch."
Mm-hmm.
I mean, make the jokes where you can, mm-hmm. you know? The trial was when the shenanigans really began, because it garnered national attention, of course. So all of a sudden, these activists had a platform.
Right.
And of course, Hoffman and Reuben used this in their prankster, trickster way.
It's a circus!
That's right. At one point, they showed up wearing judges' robes to the trial. And of course, the judge said, you need to remove those. And they took them off and they had police uniforms underneath. I mean, things like mm-hmm. this. Just spectacle. I love it. And all of this is on the news, right? People are seeing it. So at least it creates a discussion, if nothing else. Paul Krasner said to the New York Times in 2003, "It's strange to be 70 and still identify with a youth movement, but I'd rather identify with evolution than stagnation."
Always, yeah. Well, I also love that the type of conservatism they were protesting and playing pranks on had a rule book that was so set that they were able to make them the other part of this play. Like, we know exactly what you're going to do at every moment.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to insist we take this off. So what do we have underneath it? Like, yeah. And then you're going to insist we take that off. So then do we go naked in the court? Like, what do we, you know?
You have to know the establishment and the systems and the actions in place
mm-hmm.
that you're fighting against in order to attack them properly.
So maybe it's just a really great example of the fact that people who are farther from the center of power always see the center more clearly than the center sees itself.
Yep. Of course, famously, the Chicago Seven were found guilty, but then the charges were dismissed on appeal. So just wrapping up that little piece. The next person I'd like to talk about is Joey Skaggs. Joey Skaggs has also had an illustrious career in political pranking, and he began his career around the time the Yippies did as well. So Joey Skaggs was an art student who says that he really didn't have the patience to try and build a career and get famous. He was super into instant gratification.
How nice that he can admit that. So many of us suffer, and he's just, yep, that's how it is.
He's also said that he's always felt an intense conflict with himself and the way the world is. So this gave him an artistic way to express that conflict and frustration, right? So in 1968, the year of this infamous DNC in Chicago, he was frustrated that buses of tourists were flocking to the Lower East Side to gawk at the hippies. They would bus in tourists who would remain in the bus and ride through the Lower East Side and snap photos of hippies from there. Bus.
Nice. So it's an urban safari.
Yes.
But hippies are the lions.
Exactly. So he, in turn, rented a bus and brought a busload of hippies to Queens, which was pretty suburban back then. Mm. And they walked around and took pictures of people mowing their lawns and going for walks. The reaction was that the squares were being invaded, right? Like they kind of freaked out. I discovered that afterwards, Greyhound actually, in all seriousness, approached Skaggs about running hippie tours to suburban areas. And of course, he declined. But they saw it as a potential moneymaker.
My God. Okay.
If the hippies have anything, it's tons of disposable cash, right?
Unfortunately, yes, that's true. Yes, most of them then went to work for their father's law firms a couple of years after that, unfortunately.
So shortly after this, he decided to protest the Vietnam War. On Christmas Day, he built a nativity scene in Central Park that was staged to look like a Vietnamese village.
Oh, yeah.
The plan was for he and his fellow protesters and activists in military gear to burn the village down.
Oh, my God, yeah.
The police actually interceded and broke this up, and they were confronted, and many of them were arrested. But Joey Skaggs was upset because the media coverage got it all wrong. They promoted the story that the police were busting the hippies for littering. And there was another piece that said the police broke up a hippie sex ring.
Oh my God.
They were completely missing his message. So at this point, he really hones in on his message and he decides to go after the media. And that's been the bulk of his career moving forward. Not always, but that's been his main focus. He wanted to go after the gullibility of the media, as well as their laziness and lack of desire to fact check things. It's interesting to see this because now we're in this position where people don't believe the media when it is based in fact. Mm. So it's something distinct of that moment.
So he's essentially calling, I mean, he's not calling them out, but like the media, like a reporter would go to a situation like this and ask a cop, hey, what's going on? And the cop would be like, oh, these hippies are littering. And they just, oh, these hippies are littering. And like with no further questions, like no actual investigation or curiosity about what might be going on. Yeah.
And I'll get into a couple of his pranks so that maybe it'll become clear what I'm talking about. Joey really likes to create elaborate characters, which I love. So he takes on full costume. There have been times when he's had his teeth altered. Wow. He's had, you know, veneers made and things like that. He creates a complete persona with a costume. For example, in 1976, he claimed to open a brothel for dogs.
Okay.
This was reported all over the media. They came to the dog brothel. They loved this story. And I think with Joey, his point is about the media. Hmm. Sometimes he has a sub point, you know, and sometimes it's just something to just see if they'll buy it, right?
He's going fishing. He's going fishing and the dog brothel is the bait.
Yeah, exactly. And they totally bought it, hook, line, and sinker. Also in 1976, he claimed to be the owner of a celebrity sperm bank. The whole scenario was that he was going to hold a celebrity sperm auction.
Oh my God.
he had actors play angry attorneys suing for paternity and their upset clients and rabid fans explaining which celebrity sperm they were going to get. Of course, eventually the sperm bank was quote unquote robbed and all the sperm was gone, so they couldn't have their auction.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
You know, obviously he's generating media attention for bullshit stories. He has a cool moral code, which is that he insists on leaving in details and hints that it's totally fake.
Yeah.
So that anyone who bothered to do a modicum of fact checking would realize it's a hoax. And he also eventually reveals the prank always.
It's so great because, like, as you said, his goal is not to put one over on people. His goal is to, like, demonstrate how lazy and how they're just like a megaphone for whoever talks to them first. The media act, you know, that wasn't quite English, but you get me.
I know what you're talking about. In 1984, he formed a pseudo-military group called Walk Right! Exclamation point to police people who don't follow proper walking etiquette.
Oh my God. Pass on the left, jerk!
And most recently, in 2018, he staged a faux military parade for Trump that marched down Fifth Avenue toward Trump Tower with Putin, Kim Jong-un, and Trump lookalikes carrying toy weapons.
Mm-hmm.
That's Joey Skaggs.
Oh my God, we love him.
A little taste of Joey Skaggs. Just Wikipedia him, everybody, because his pranks are great.
Joey Skaggs.
Yeah. The documentary, The Art of the Prank, that's on YouTube, is about him and his career. So there's a lot of information in there. I'm not being sarcastic when I say an illustrious career. It's great.
I'm sorry. He's had an illustrious career from dog brothels to celebrity sperm banks.
Right.
It's amazing.
You would love that. So something I didn't know was that the Upright Citizens Brigade started with some activist leanings, tendencies. There is a connection between theater and improv and these kind of events. So this is a story that Adam McKay tells on Conan O'Brien Needs a Friend, the great podcast. In 1992, a conglomeration of corn sweetener producers was union busting in the Midwest. So they were firing union employees, and there had been 6 to 7 months of a union lockout. According to Adam, entire small towns were destroyed by these corporations' actions. Pepsi was one of the largest purchasers of corn syrup in the country, and probably still is, and they just so happened to be one of the major sponsors of the grand opening of Navy Pier in Chicago. So Ian Roberts, Adam McKay, and a few other actors descended on the event. Adam pretended to be a representative of Pepsi. He went to the 99-cent store and bought a Pepsi t-shirt as the event was happening, walked up to the people running the event and said, they acted really blasé and casual and said, oh yeah, we're from Pepsi. We're supposed to do this thing after the band plays. And of course, you know, you pretend you belong there. Mm-hmm. Everybody believes you. So the people in charge were like, oh yeah, sure. You know, and who even knows if they were the people in charge? Who's at the stage right that moment, you know?
This is fully Therese's ego, but I just want to say, like, it's possible to manage events well, you guys. It's possible to do it.
Pause for this PSA.
Yeah, it is possible for the person organizing the thing to know that Pepsi is not supposed to do a speech after the band. Somebody should know that, and they should be there.
And once again, exploiting gullibility. This comes up over and over again of taking advantage of people who were asleep at the fucking wheel.
That's right. Yes.
So Adam and the other actor with him that are playing these Pepsi representatives get up on stage. They hold this raffle. They say to horrible things like, hey, let's get some Pepsi spirit going. You know, mm-hmm. They start pulling people from the crowd up. But in the crowd, there were some actors that started protesting.
Mm.
And they were supposed to, they were not, but they were supposed to be people who were affected by these lockouts, right? And who had lost their jobs. So eventually the actors were brought up on stage one by one, telling really sad stories about the repercussions of this lockout. They lost their jobs. They lost their homes. They lost their families. So Adam and his Pepsi guys would shift saying, that's too bad, but whoever can roll this Pepsi can across the stage with their nose will win $20. So they have these actors playing people going through these horribly difficult events, rolling Pepsi cans mm-hmm. across the stage with their nose for $20 and mm-hmm. sort of doing it in this dejected way, you know, mm-hmm. like, okay, mm-hmm. you know, I could use $20 or whatever.
So good.
It's so brilliant. Eventually, this was all planned. The actors staged a riot where the protesters started approaching the stage, pulling down the Pepsi signs and chanting. So the police showed up and they started arresting the actors. Adam's like, oh shit. Okay. The jig is up. I'm busted, right? Any second they're going to come over here and arrest me. So of course the police come up to him and they say, so, how do you guys at Pepsi want to handle this? And he was flabbergasted and he said, oh yeah, you know, I think we've had enough bad press lately. Why don't we just go ahead and let him go? And the police were like, all right, your call. They let everybody go. My and God. he said he hightailed it out of there.
Sure. I didn't know I could run this fast. Oh my God. Look at me go. I should have been in track. Oh my, look, I'm still running, you guys. Look how fast I'm going.
I've always liked Adam McKay and his work, but this just brought him to a whole nother level of estimation in my mind. There is a network of artists, activists, and organizers called Beautiful Trouble online, which is the best name ever. Mm-hmm. Let's just be clear. Their website is beautifultrouble.org. I highly recommend it. It's a great resource. They're dedicated to sharing their tactics and ideas with others. So they have trainings and online toolboxes on their website. It's a really good resource for people who are interested in pranktivism. I'd like to just read a little bit of their mission statement. Quote, we believe in people power and the game-changing role that creativity, humor, joy, and mischief can play in the struggle for a better world, end quote. One of the things they do on their website is document the actions of some of their participants. One of the groups that is featured on their website is the Barbie Liberation Organization.
I don't know them, but I very much like their name.
Oh, you love them. You just wait. Everybody, you love them. In 1993, a team of activists switched out talking Barbie and G.I. Joe voice boxes. This was a reaction to a talking Barbie that had been released the year before that said, math is hard.
Yeah, I remember that one.
This was in reaction to that. They purchased the dolls, took them home, switched out the voice boxes. So in the end, Barbie was saying things like, dead men tell no lies. And G.I. Joe was saying, I love to shop with you. They would place them back on the shelves after they were altered. They wouldn't do anything like return it, right? So there was no theft or fraud involved. Mm-hmm. They just put them back on the shelves. And in the box, they'd include an instruction sheet to parents, including the numbers for local media on how to report it. They had this brilliant plan of ways in which they could get the word out and make a bigger deal about it than it was. They did it to something like 50 toys, but they would also be really strategic in that they'd figure out where the media coverage was going to be, and they'd race to the store and put one on the shelf. So the reporter would walk up, push the button and go, got it, and go to the register and buy the toy. Very quickly, the media started to exaggerate the claim. So again, they did it to like 50 toys, but by the next Christmas, it was like thousands of toys, right? So they had completely let the media build their own fuel around it. This prank was engineered at least partly by Mike Bonanno, and he's one of the ones that I don't know if this is his real name, but we'll hear more about him later. He's part of a group called the Yes Men. Another great campaign that's on the Beautiful Trouble website is Billionaires for Bush.
Yeah. At the various, little baby Teresa went to her anarchist protests in the 90s and 2000s. And my favorite group of people were the Billionaires for Bush or Gore. Doesn't matter. Billionaires for Bush or Gore. We're cool with either. I loved them.
In 2000, at a campaign dinner, George W. Bush said the following, quote, what an impressive crowd, the haves and the have-mores. Mm-hmm. Some people call you the elite. I call you my base, right? I mean, solid jokes, but gross.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. No, like the humor's there is just super disgusting. Look, the devil's funny.
So a group of activists founded by Andrew Boyd dressed up as stereotypically wealthy people and campaigned, ironically, for George W. Bush. What's great about this project is that they're all artists. They're designers, they're actors, they're producers. In 2000, as you mentioned, they called themselves Billionaires for Bush. Or Gore, in parentheses. So they tried to auction off advertising rights to the Liberty Bell, and they held a vigil for corporate welfare. They also sent a Karl Rove imposter to a GOP fundraiser. When they were running this campaign, they got a lot of media attention because it was funny, it was well executed, and it was designed to easily spread nationally. So they were recruiting people to, or at least giving people the tools to be able to do this themselves. They would name their characters. There's Phil T. Rich and Mo Bloodfer Oil. They often mimicked Bush's campaign logos and replaced the Republican elephant with a piggy bank stuffed with bills. They had slogans on billboards, signs, and bumper stickers. Some of my favorites are the following. Cheney is innocent. 2 million jobs lost. It's a start. Billionaires for Bush, because we're all in this together. Sort of. And corporations are people, too. Billionaires for Bush fully supported Bush in 2004. They attended Bush campaign events, rallies, and even attended the RNC. When the mayor of New York banned 500,000 anti-Bush protesters from Central Park, the group held a croquet match there, saying it was to promote their cause to privatize Central Park. Mm-hmm. Another great group to research and learn more about there. What were your interactions with them like when you were out in the field?
Yeah, they were always, so we always showed up in, black clothes with a band t-shirt, and we were just sort of there. And I was always impressed because they were actually performing. Like, they had a thing they were doing and it was really good and funny. And I was like, oh, I'm just a body. I mean, bodies are necessary, but I really liked that. I was like, oh, you guys put so much, like, look at your cause. I mean, they were beautiful. They had on, top hat and tux and tails and just beautiful, like, dressed very stereotypically wealthy.
Evening gowns, pearls.
Exactly. So many sequins and beaded dresses. So many, they were like carrying a tray of caviar, real or fake. They weren't carrying it. They actually had servants with them. That was part of the, it was so great. Yeah.
It has to be realistic.
That's right. I would never actually care. I would never serve, dear.
One of the great things on the Beautiful Trouble website is for each prank, they break down the tactics. And one of the tactics they point out with Billionaires for Bush is don't dress like a protester.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They instantly stood out from the crowd and they gained more attention and sort of played against the stereotypes of protesters and played toward the stereotypes of wealthy people. The news at 9 likes a good image, right? And so there you've got these group of people. So good. So now we're going to talk about the Yes Men.
Yay.
So the Yes Men were established in 1996. As I mentioned, Mike Bonanno is a part of them, and so is Andy Bechelbaum, which may or may not be their real names. I'm not 100% sure. So, full disclosure, I did the research. The Yes Men specialize in creating fake websites for various corporations and entities, such as Monsanto. So they start by either telling the truth about the organization or creating information they wish were true. The film The Yes Men is a documentary about their trolling of the World Trade Organization. It started because they created a fake website for the World Trade Organization. Of course, it mimics the look of the real website, but if you actually read it, it tells the truth about how the policies of the WTO are designed to protect corporations from the citizens and governments of the nations they operate or trade with. So in this movie, they create the fake WTO website, but then people start contacting them thinking they're the actual WTO to speak at conferences, which is batshit because they just didn't read any of the website. They were like, oh, this is it. Andy and Mike go to Finland to make the speech to a group of professionals from the global textile industry.
Oh, that's awesome.
Andy plays the part of this WTO representative, seriously delivering a satirized version of the WTO beliefs. I'm gonna tell you what he said in his speech because it's shocking. He basically argued that in United States history, slavery would have eventually worked itself out in favor of a more efficient system of commerce eventually. So his problem with slavery is that it's inefficient. It's obviously a horrible thing to say. It may be that in that context, it's important to say horrible things like that to try and draw attention to it. The thing that was absolutely shocking to me is that no one in the room reacted. Because it's delivered by a white man who appears professional and is speaking in relatively professional tones, there's no reaction.
Yeah, the things we will allow from people, yeah, exactly, who have the right look.
This entire speech culminates in a demonstration of a new technology whereby managers can remotely monitor their workers. So Andy rips off his business suit and reveals a golden bodysuit that hugs every curve. He pulls a tab and the suit's crotch inflates, revealing a huge golden penis with a video screen at the tip.
Oh my God.
And as this is happening, there were some titters of laughter, but they went to dinner later. Like, no one reacted as if this was odd or shocking. Andy and Mike continue posing as the WTO, making a speech at a university in Philadelphia. And there, again, as the WTO, they promote a fake technology whereby human waste can be recycled into food for developing nations. Once again, I'm super uncomfortable even saying that.
Uh-huh.
But here's what's amazing. The students were not having it.
Ah.
So once again, they do this thing where there's like all the horribly shocking things they say in weirdly neutral tones.
Yeah.
And then there's a shocker, which is it was the golden penis in the first one. And then in this one is the revelation of this technology. But they didn't even get through the speech. And the students were like, excuse me, what you just said is wrong, offensive, and horrifying.
Yeah.
And so the students just nailed them over and over again. They finally get to the whole recycling of food. And you just see the students' faces like, what the fuck is going on here? Finally, the students started throwing things at them and booing them out of the room.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Andy and Mike were thrilled. Mm-hmm. They were like, this is the reaction that is normal and human. This is the reaction we want. Like, we want outrage. It's the groups of adults that are fucking crazy, man, that they sit through this shit. You know, students were leaving.
Yeah.
The film is about their history with the WTO. So the finale is that they make a speech at a conference of accountants in Australia where they announce the end of the WTO, explaining that the WTO has examined its actions and realized that its policies support corporations and not people, and that there has to be a more sustainable model. And so they're going to retreat from their organization, rethink things, and come back as a force for good in the world. This just comes up again and again in this topic, which is taking advantage of people's willingness to go with the flow if everything seems okay. Mm-hmm. Appearance on the surface, right? So there's lots of other cool groups. There's the Billboard Liberation Front. They've been altering billboards in California since the 70s with a specifically anti-corporate message. My favorite is a Stella Artois billboard. So there's a sort of chic 60s Italian couple. The man is on one side of the billboard, the woman's on the other. Between them is a lot of white negative space with the Stella Artois logo very discreetly placed. The tagline under the logo was, "She is a thing of beauty." And they just took off of beauty. And it just says, "She is a thing."
So great.
There's another group called the Gorilla Girls, who are an intersectional feminist who go after the male gaze, sexism, and discrimination in the arts specifically. They have a book called The Art of Behaving Badly, which I will be purchasing ASAP. That kind of wraps up my overview of some of these groups, but I was wondering what the effect of the Trump administration and the sort of surreal nature of the last few years in politics has been on groups like this, because they deal in the surreal and the absurd.
What do you do when the thing you're protesting is at least as absurd and surreal as the thing you thought you were going to do to protest it?
We're going to turn to the Yes Men's website, which is theyesmen.org, for some answers on this. They say on their website, quote, "Against a sociopathic president, satire is probably useless," end quote. They have a page on their website that says, "When fascism threatens, take proven action, period. Sign up to be a poll worker, send postcards, protest in the streets."
I love that.
And they say this because they launched several pranks leading into and during the Trump administration that simply did not work because of how surreal everything became. So they launched a website called doctorsforopeningamerica.com that was supposed to be a satirical Trump initiative to get medical professionals to spread pro-death ads. They even wrote a song where the singer volunteers to sacrifice himself to the economy. Obviously, this didn't work or shock anyone because it's basically what the administration did during the pandemic. It's hard to hold up a satirical mirror, as you said, to society when society has hit the upper limits of surreal.
Like, maybe humor doesn't work when the thing you're... I mean, just if somebody's batshit, like, satire is not the answer.
Yeah. And so I'm really curious to see where this goes now, because a large goal of these actions is to create a dialogue. It's not to say that everything's fixed, but there is some progress on the front of having a dialogue on some of these topics. And also, we have flirted with fascism in this country now.
Oh, yeah. We're full on making out with fascism in the dark corner of a party.
Who knows where it's going? And so how will this evolve? What role does it play moving forward? We'll just have to see.
But I love that their response is like, yeah, so no jokes for the fascists. Go to work at the polls, drive people to vote, punch a Nazi. That's my suggestion, not theirs. Go ahead and punch a Nazi. You know, it feels good.
I just want to return to this idea of making the invisible visible for a second. In some of these actions, especially with the yes men, there's an unspoken question to the audience, which is, what is enough? By speaking what's usually unspoken, like some of the things I mentioned in their speeches, by overtly stating the belief behind the actions of these corporations and organizations, or pushing those beliefs one degree more extreme than they currently are, they're asking us, at what point are you going to stand up and say something? Now? How about now?
How about now?
That's why it was so inspiring to see those students revolt against them and their positions in this moment. I was also thinking about why you would never in a million gazillion years see a conservative activist pull a prank. And I was thinking about something you said, which I think you credited to someone else, but I want to ask you to say it again. It was something about thinking you're in one world and a joke being the realization that you're in another, or one story or something. Do you remember?
Yeah, I think it's from a book. I think actually Jimmy Carr may have written this book, which is hilarious to me that I'm citing Jimmy Carr. But there it is. And if you know Jimmy Carr, you know why that's weird. He said, you know, a joke is, and he got it from someone, like, this is, you know, people who think about what humor is from an academic standpoint know these things. So he said a joke is essentially two stories. And the punchline shows you that while you thought you were in the first story, you're actually in the second. The punchline hops you from one narrative to another. And that's why it's a shock, which is why it's funny.
Right.
And so I think that the reason you'll never find conservatives doing that is because for conservatives, it's very, very important to them that they know the story they're in. They like to pretend it's the only possible story, right? And so this thing of where you can have a different perspective on events, and when you can shift perspective and look at it from a different, that's not a strength of conservatives.
And I think it's also because they're part of the established narrative. They are the establishment. They don't want to be in another narrative. A joke pushes things forward, and they're not interested in moving forward. The only change they want is to go backwards.
That's right.
Which is the opposite of a joke.
That's right. Yeah, that's... Mm-hmm.
What's the opposite of a joke? Conservatism.
That's it. That's a great... Yep.
And I think what's the opposite of a joke? Fascism.
Yeah, fascism is the opposite of humor. There was a thing that went around about how Disney, like the cartoonists at Disney, were working so hard and like really, like the conditions they were working in were just not like humane working conditions. Like it was many hours, it was breakless and whatever. And so they started referring to their jobs as, I work in Auschwitz.
Oh, shit.
And upper management... Management heard about it and sent out a memo like, anyone heard using this phrase is going to be fired immediately. And so like the fascist reaction to making fun of fascism is to become more fascist. Like the only tool they have is a hammer, right? But the people who work there immediately pivoted and started calling it Duckow. Like, there's always another joke to make, is the point. You can always find another joke to make. But if your whole thing is that you're not allowed to make jokes, or no, that's not funny, or you can't have that perspective, you really only have one move, which is no.
Yeah, fascists respond to jokes by becoming more fascist. Jesus Christ. Ugh.
I mean, because what else can you do? I mean, you're not like a flexible thinker. If you're a fascist, you're not a flexible thinker. It's not like you can be swayed by new information. Oh, man. That was so cool, Claire. Thank you for telling me about all those things.
You're welcome.
I'm going to find Yes Men immediately.
Oh, I should also say that Yes Men have, I think, 3 films. So please check them out. there's the Yes Men is the first one, I believe. And there's another one called The Yes Men Save the World. And there's several. So check out them. Check out Joey Skaggs. Educate yourself about Abbie Hoffman and the Yippies. Check out the Gorilla Girls. I mean, I just find these acts of absurdist theater so inspiring. Let's go out and make some mischief, everybody.
Yes, positive mischief. Go. Thanks, everybody. We will talk to you again very soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Testing. Great. Thank you for listening to It Chooses You. Your hosts are Teresa Sparks and Claire Patton. Our theme song is by Bobby Dart. If you'd like to get in touch with us, drop us an email at itchoosesyoupodcast@gmail.com.